好，那我们下面开始我们今天的第一个 technical session。那我们先有请进。
Okay, we're going to get started again. Yes, you have to listen to me talk again. I promise you this will be the last time you'll have to hear me talk for the next couple days, at least up on this stage. So, Chinyang and I are going to talk about compression and encryption in SPDK. So, just, you know, briefly, maybe just give a little bit of overview of what, you know, what we're talking about with SPDK and accelerators, like Intel Quick Assist. I'm going to talk a little bit about the block compression work that I referred to in my keynote earlier this morning. And then Chinyang is going to go over a couple of areas where SPDK has incorporated encryption in different layers of the I/O stack. Okay, so here we've got the, you know, one of the standard SPDK I/O paths. We've got an NVMe namespace down here. We're using logical volumes, and we have a couple of logical volume block devices that have been constructed on that. So the first thing that we added, I guess early this year, were some of these block services. So the first one was encryption. So I talked about this briefly, but being able to crypto, so take a logical volume, be able to have a key, and then be able to encrypt and decrypt that data specifically for that logical volume using that key. And then more recently, we've added compression. So again, being able to take a logical volume, this is going to be thin provision, be able to create a compressed block on top of it. So you have I/O that come in, this is going to compress it, and then it's going to store the compressed blocks down here at the logical volume. And the way that we do that is with an accelerator framework. So one of the things that we looked at early on was there's a lot of libraries out there that are doing this type of acceleration. We didn't want to do our own SPDK. We looked at what can we leverage that's already out there. And so what we did was we're leveraging the DPK framework for this. So they've built a pretty nice set of APIs, compressed dev, crypto dev, and SPDK codes to those APIs. And so then what it means is DPK is taking care of in the background what the actual implementations are. So they have a number of plugins. I'm just listing a few of them here. But it can use Quick Assist, so if Quick Assist is available on the system, it will use Quick Assist to do the encryption and the compression. If it's not available, then it will use optimized software routines like ISL or IPsecNB to do those operations instead. And so this is really nice because in SPDK, we can code to a common DPDK interface, and then we're leveraging all the work that the DPDK community is doing to either do those in optimized software or offload those to accelerators. Okay, so now digging into the details on how we're doing compression in SPDK. So this is similar to the slides that I showed in the keynote. There's three parts to this. First, the DPDK framework. So this is where we're using that to actually do the compression algorithms itself. PMDK for actually storing the compression metadata, SPDK logical volumes for doing the capacity savings, and the key part, which I'm going to talk about now, is this what we're calling libreduce. So this is a new library that's inside of SPDK that is responsible for managing how we're going to manage the compressed blocks. So the blocks come in, we're going to compress them, where do we store them, how do we store the compression metadata. And that's what I'm going to talk about over the next few minutes. So the key components to libreduce is first we have a block device. And so we call the backing IO units. These are effectively the compressed blocks. So once we have data that comes in, we compress it, and once the data is compressed, we store that on disk, and we call those backing IO units. I'll talk in more detail about that in a little bit. And then we have a persistent memory file for all the mapping metadata. So we have to keep track of, once we have data that comes in, and we compress it, and now we have a fewer number of blocks storing this. Later, we have to go look that up. We're using persistent memory to do that. And the nice thing here is we're using PMDK directly, so in libreduce, we're calling into PMDK to do all those persistent memory operations. So again, this is it's directly dependent on PMDK, but it's not directly dependent on any specific persistent memory. You heard Andy talk about how PMDK is it's broad. It works on any persistent memory capable device, and that's why we're using that here. And then we also have some metadata on this block device. So the metadata basically, if you're familiar with SPDK and how the block device layer works, is once a new block device shows up, each of the VDEV modules in SPDK gets a chance to look at it and see if it wasn't claimed or not. So in this case, we'll look at the metadata on that block device. It'll see the metadata that says, yeah, this is part of libreduce. It'll have some parameters, basically, what size of chunks are we going to try to compress, maybe what the compression algorithm is. And then it also gives us the path to that persistent memory file. And the key part here is, when we talk about libreduce, this is just the metadata algorithm. How are we storing the metadata for the compressed blocks and where they map to? We're using standard compression algorithms to actually do the compression. We are not inventing a new compression algorithm for SPDK. Libreduce is just, how do we actually use those standard compression algorithms to achieve block compression? Okay, so here I'm going to go through some of the basic flows on how libreduce works. So the first part here is initialization. So at the beginning, you decide, I have a block device, I have some persistent memory, I want to create a compressed file. And so that's where this init call comes in. Later, if you already have a compressed volume, then you're going to call this load routine. In SPDK, we use this actually to also detect, does this block device even contain a libreduce volume? So for those that are familiar with SPDK, when the compression VDEV library, when it sees that there's a new block device, we'll call the volume load routine. And it will do one of two things. One, it will tell us, no, there is no libreduce on here. And so then we will continue on and allow somebody else to claim that block device. Or if it says, yes, it does contain it, then we'll get a pointer back and we can now start to do I/O operations on that device. So next, once you have your reduced volume loaded, you can start to do read V and write V operations on it. And those operations are going to generate a couple of different callbacks. So when you load, one thing is PMEM persist. So like Andy said, once you have persistent memory loaded, you just do reads and writes to them. Loads and stores. And at the critical points in some of the mapping tables that I'm going to describe later, we will call out to PMEM persist, actually call out to PMDK and make sure that the data is persistent to memory. And then we'll actually do the read V and write V and unmask to the backing device. So once we have the compressed blocks, we'll do a write V to write them, or if we have to read them, then we'll read them in. And then we also have operations out to do the compressed and decompressed operations themselves. So the key part here is that this libreduce is completely independent from the SPDK framework or the block device layer. So what we wanted to do was to show how this could be implemented, but it's not tied to the VDEV layer. So theoretically, if you wanted to use the same compression algorithm, but you had your own block device library, or you had your own SPDK framework, you could still use this same library, and you could implement those yourselves. And in fact, that's how it's really nice, because it gives us a very nice framework to be able to unit test this library as well. One of the key points here, I'm going to talk about chunks. So we have to decide in SPDK what size of data are we going to try to compress on. And so by default, we pick 16 kilobytes. That's configurable. But the key part here is that the caller, whoever's integrating this library, is responsible for ensuring that IOs don't cross one of those chunk properties. We already have facilities in the SPDK block device layer to do that today fairly easy. But we specifically made that call just because we didn't want to add the extra complexity to the Liberty's library itself. And then it's also single threaded per compression volume. So there's quite a bit of coordination that has to be done inside of the Liberty's library. For example, if you are doing reads and writes to the same chunk simultaneously, and we wanted to avoid having to do locks inside of Liberty's. We hate locks. We don't like to do locks. So what we do in this case is we will do message passing if we need to. If there's a logical volume that's being accessed from multiple cores, then we will do message passing and actually submit the I/O to the Liberty's. Okay, so let's lay out. I'm going to go into some more low-level details on how this works. So here, this yellow, we're going to call this the backing device. So this is like an SSD. Let's assume this is actually a logical volume. So it's a logical partition of an SSD. And we break this up into I/O units. So by default, we do 4K I/O units. Most NVMe SSDs that are out there today are physically organized internally on 4K, so that's a really nice round number. It helps us get the maximum performance when we're doing the write operations. And then we have our persistent memory file. All the metadata is based on chunks. So first what we do is we set up what's called a chunk map. Each of these entries is associated with a different chunk of the block device. So I mentioned that by default, this is 16 kilobytes, it's configurable. But what it does is it maps the logical chunk to which I/O units on disk. So for example, here we can see we had a 16K chunk of data, it compressed down to this many bytes, and those bytes are stored in these I/O units. So we can see how those are pointed there. And then we have what's called the logical map. And so the logical map is what we do to look and see. So for example, here, what we're saying is if the user goes to read an offset 48 kilobytes into the block device, it's saying, okay, well that 16K of data points to here. That compressed data, 10,121 bytes, is in those I/O units. Now we have all the data we need to be able to go and read that data. Okay, so bear with me. I'm going to go through a few examples on how this works, which I think is going to more clearly illustrate not just how the algorithm works, but also how persistent memory really makes this possible. So this is basically the state of the compressed volume at time zero. So we have just initialized it. This is the first I/O operation that we are going to perform on this compressed block device. So first we look up, we're doing a read to offset zero, we look in the logical map, and this is empty. So that means there's no data. We don't have to go read any data first and do a read modify write. So the first thing we do is we allocate a chunk entry in the chunk map. So we know in this chunk map which entries are being used. And then we compress the chunk data. So we got 4K of data from the user, but the chunk is 16K. So we are basically going to compress 4K of user data with 12K of zeros, and this is going to compress down very, very nicely, for example, with 2,500 bytes. So 2,500 bytes, we know we can store that in one I/O unit. We said the I/O units are 4K, so we allocate one of the backing I/O units, and we can see first we write the data out to the SSD, that's what those X's are there for. Then we can write in our chunk map, so we're saying, oh, we compress this down to 2,500 bytes, that data is stored in backing I/O unit 0. And then finally, this is what makes it persistent, right? Because now we say for this offset, the data for it is here. And so this is where the key part is, where after we write this data, we'll do a PMEP persist, and and then we will write this and do another PMEM persist, and now the data is persistent. If the system goes down, when we come back up, we're going to be in a consistent state. Either we're going to see that this is valid and points to a valid chunk map entry, or let's assume that this actually didn't get, this got committed, but this did not get committed. We would see that, oh, there's nothing here, so this is no data, right? So this is the key entry that makes the data valid. Okay, so now let's take an example of writing 16K. So this is a full chunk at offset 64K. So again, we look up in the logical map entry, we see that that entry is empty. We allocate a new chunk, new entry in the chunk map. Now this is interesting. We go to compresses 16K of data, and it only compresses down to 14,000 bytes. So if you round this up, it's going to take 4 I/O units to store that data. Well, it would be silly to store 4 I/O units of compressed data. We might as well use the 4 I/O units to store the uncompressed data, because then when we read it back later, we can save on the decompression operation. So what we'll actually do is we'll allocate 4 of the backing I/O units. We'll write the uncompressed data out to the SSD. And then here, later, we'll know. If we go back and read this data later, we see, oh, we got 16K here. So we'll know later that we can go read that data directly. We won't have to decompress it. And we'll go ahead and write and persist the logical map entry. Okay, so now the next case, which is adds a little bit of complexity here. We're going to write 4K, but we're going to write it at offset 4K. So it's still in that first chunk, right? So now when we go and we look this up, we see, oh, there's already some data here. So now we're going to have to do a read-modify write. And this is really where I was talking about this has to be single-threaded, because we have to keep a list internally of what the outstanding operations are, because with these read-modify writes, we can't have multiple ones going in sequence. They have to be serialized. So what we have to do first is we have to read the compressed data. So we know that we're going to go read logical block, or the backing IO unit 0. Only the first 2,500 bytes are valid. And so we're going to decompress it, and that should decompress into 16K. If it doesn't, there's an error. But in the primary case, that's going to decompress to 16K. And then what we're going to do is we're going to merge the incoming 4K of data that came in from the user. That's another key part here. We're going to allocate a new chunk map entry. So we don't want to overwrite this one, because again, we're really concerned about power fail safety. So we're going to actually allocate this new chunk map entry here. Let's say this compresses down to 5K. We allocate 2 backing I/O units, and now we can write the compressed data to the SSD. This is the other key part. We don't want to overwrite the data, right? So we don't want to overwrite this one, because again, for power fail safety, if we come back, we need this data to be here. So we allocate two new backing I/O units. We write the new entry here. And then here's the key part. So if you notice, we replace the 0 with a 2. So at any point here, if at this point we have written this and the system crashes, when we come back, this will still point to the old data, which points to here. Or if it gets switched over, this is an atomic operation, it's an 8-byte write, it'll point to the new data instead. So I think this really shows the power of using persistent memory for these types of algorithms, because it allows us to do these operations very, very quickly, atomically, and be able to save a lot of the latency from having to store that metadata on disk. And so then once that's done, once we've committed this entry in the logical map, now we can go and we can internally clear this, and reuse those for new operations. Okay, a couple more, and then I'm going to hand it over to Chunyang. So trim. So let's say we want to trim data. This is a really simple use case. So we want to trim the 16K of data stored right here. Well, this is really easy. All we have to do is just erase the logical map entry. That's it. And so now once we come back up, the key part is that when we reload, we read this first, And even if there's data here, these entries aren't valid unless something here points to them. So in this case, we've cleared this. If the system goes down, nobody's going to be pointing to this anymore, and so this will just be ignored when the system, when the logical map is reloaded later. Okay, I think the last example we have here is where we're actually going to read some of the data. So here we look at the logical map. We see it points to entry 2. We're going to go read these two I.O. units. Now we're going to decompress that data again. So the key part here is we only want 4K of it. So what we're going to do is the target has provided us a user buffer. It said, I want you to read 4K of data, and I want you to put it in here. So when we do the decompression, what we don't want to do is decompress it into a 16K buffer and then copy the 4K. We basically pass an I.O. vector array. So we basically put the target user buffer for the 4K and then just a bit bucket. So when I say bit bucket, it just means we're going to read it into some memory buffer, but it's not actually going to be used for anything. So that allows us to save on the memory copy. Okay, so hopefully that gives you some examples of the power of using things like persistent memory for these type of algorithms. We've got some, a few things we still need to do. Unmap operations, there's things we can do to track some of the subchunk allocations. So I talked about, when we write 4K of data, there's 12K that's unallocated there. There's actually some savings we can get if we keep track of those. Another one that we get a lot of questions about is, can I see performance data? So we're actively working on this. We don't have it yet, but that's actively in progress. And then there's some additional on-disk metadata parameters that we want to store. So currently today, what you'll see out of SPDK is defaulting to deflate. We need to add some on-disk metadata on there to be able to store different types of algorithms, potentially even compression levels, et cetera. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Chunyang, who's going to give you some more details on how we do crypto and encryption within SPDK.
Thank you, Jim. 大家好，我是来自英特尔NCRG team的惠春阳，我现在主要负责的是 ISO 和 SPDK 的开发。那么接下来我会给大家带来就是 SPDK 在 crypto 这方面的支持。首先主要是两个方面，一部分是 对于任意 DDEV 组成的 virtual DDEV 进行加密，另外一部分是对于支持 OPPO 协议的 NVMe 设备进行加密。那么接下来，我们先来看可以对任意 DDEV 进行加密的 crypto DDEV。就像刚才 Jim 介绍的 compress DDEV 一样。 Crypto VBDEV 它也是使用了 PDK Framework 里面的组件，这里使用的是 Crypto DEV。 Crypto DEV 它由硬件和软件的 PMD 组成，它使用统一的接口。如果你有 QAT 这样的加速卡，它就会自动的去使用；如果你没有的话，它就会默认的使用软件的这种方案去做加解密。 Crypto DEV 它本身提供非常丰富的加密的选项，然后如果有对这一块比较感兴趣的话，可以去参考 DPDK 的官方文档，里面有非常详细的描述。Crypto DEV 它使用起来是相对来说比较容易的，它可以在不增加任何硬件的情况下，就只是纯软件就可以。 利用现有的硬件平台就可以跑起来，而且可以就是用来对你任何的 BDEV 或者 VBDEV 进行一个加密的支持。比如说，你可以用NVMe 或者 AIO 这样的BDEV， 然后在上面去增加一个 Crypto VBDEV 这一层，或者你也可以用 Virtual BDEV， 比如说 Split 或者是 Logic Volume， 然后在这个上面去。 增加一层 Crypto VBDEV 进行加密。 Critical VBDAG 通过用户传进去的一个 key 来对IO 进行加密，它可以保证盘上数据的安全性。需要注意的是，如果使用软件库进行加密的话，它会带来一定的资源上的开销。由于 Crypto VBDAG 它是在 DDAG 层之上构建的Virtual DDAG， 所以它可以对不同的 Base DDAG 去用不同的 key， 也可以通过 SPDK 的一些方法把单个的 namespace 或者是 Base DDAG 分割成多个，然后使用不同的 key 给不同的用户。需要注意的是，客户在使用的时候还要考虑一下密钥的安全性，因为目前就是传入 Crypto VBDAG 的密钥是没有经过加密或者是哈希这样的处理的，会直接用来加密数据。然后用户如果要使用比方说 Crypto VBDAG 在自己的生产环境上的话，他需要在上层再去增加一个就是密钥管理这样的服务。SPDK 目前还没有对这一块支持的计划。对于加密的支持，除了刚才提到的 Crypto VBDAG， 还有就是另外一种方案，就是基于 NVMe OPPO 的一个方案。接下来我会从这两个方面，就首先会介绍一下 OPPO， 然后会介绍一下 OPPO 和 SPDK 的一个集成。首先什么是 OPPO 呢？ OPPO 它其实是一系列的自加密盘的一个技术规范标准，它由 TCG 这个联盟提出。 TCG 是一个有很多大公司组成的产业联盟，它主要专注于可信计算领域，在这个领域具有非常高的权威性。那么自加密盘它主要指的是这个盘本身具有全盘自动加密的功能。自加密盘或者就是后面也可能就直接称它为 SED 或者叫 SED， 它这个盘上它有专门负责去做加解密这样的硬件，所以数据在比方说写到盘上的时候会自动加密，然后去读的时候又会自动去解密，它对于上层是可以做到完全透明的。接下来我们看两个非常重要的概念，就是 DEK 和 AK， 这是在 OPPO 中可能会经常用到的两个概念。首先 DEK 从字面上看就是 Data Encryption Key， 它主要就是为盘上数据进行加密的这样一个密钥。它是由盘上的硬件随机去生成的。这个密码它会始终留在盘上，不会被外部得到，所以它对上层完全透明，它这个密钥不会离开盘，也就可以保证你盘上数据一旦是被加密的话只能是在盘上进行解密。通过改变 DEK 可以非常简单的去做全盘的擦除这样的操作。第二个概念是 AK， 就是相当于授权的这个密钥。这个密钥它是由用户去提供的，会作为验证盘本身所属性的一个密码。用户可以利用这样可以用户可以利用 AK 去对这个盘进行加锁或者是解锁。这个密码本身它的作用其实是为了去解密刚才上面的 DEK。AK 它会在盘上以哈希值这样的形式保存。正是这两个密钥就是带来了 OPPO 的两步验证这样的特性，来保证盘上数据的安全性，同时也就是为用户使用带来了很多便利。 那么为什么我们鼓励大家去使用 OPPO 呢？首先它是基于硬件的加密，专用的加密芯片会保证它会避免就是加密成为性能的瓶颈，这样盘本身它可以几乎是满速运行的，盘上自带的加密芯片解放了 CPU， 可以去释放 CPU 的资源，而且你的负载对于 CPU 是完全透明的，也因此它可以被大规模的部署，而不用就是担心加密会占用过多的资源。第二点就是使用硬件加密无疑是提升了安全性，不管用户是否配置，盘上的数据始终是加密的。而且 OPPO 最大的特点就是它支持，就它提供了两步验证这样的一个 feature， 它负责对数据进行加密的第一 K， 它永远只会在盘上，而用户提供的密钥只用来加解，只用来对第一 K 进行加解密，这样就会保证你盘上数据的安全。第三点就是易用性， OPPO 盘在不需要任何配置的情况下可以直接使用在任何之前使用普通磁盘的情况，它对上层可以做到完全透明。有一点需要注意的是，这个时候盘上数据的安全性只能是保证你在盘的介质或者说颗粒被窃取这样的情况下数据的安全性。如果是整块盘型的丢失，如果你没有对这个盘进行配置的话，那它这个盘依然是对上层透明的，所以拿到这个盘整块盘的人他也是可以读到这个数据的。那么如果你想要做到独占的安全性的话，就需要配置软件对它进行一定的配置，这个我们后面会讲到。另外一点应用性体现在就是它可以支持更多的功能，比如可以非常简单的去做全盘的擦除，而且用户可以非常容易的去修改密码。因为考虑到安全性的话，一般数据加密使用的密钥都是会定期去修改。对于使用比方说软件加密的磁盘的话，修改密钥是比较复杂且费时的，需要把这个加密的数据先用旧密码解密，然后再用新密码重新加密之后落盘。而使用两步验证这样的机制，使得修改密码只需要去改变，只是需要去使用旧密码去解密第一 K， 然后用新密码去对第一 K 进行重新加密就可以了。刚才我们提到 OPPO 不配置的话，对上层是完全透明的，在整块盘丢失的时候它就不能保证安全性。要做到独占的安全性，就需要用户提供一个密码完成授权这样的过程，这个图上就显示了这样的过程。就盘上的，首先我们可以看到盘上的数据它始终是盘上的数据它始终是加密的，如果是没有经过 OPPO 配置的磁盘，它会使用缺省的 AK 来加密第一 K， 然后第一 K 它只会在盘上以加密的形式去保存。如果用户提供了 AK， 就会在盘上保存 A， 就只会在盘上保存 AK 的哈希。那么我们看，当用户需要从枷锁的 OPPO 磁盘上读取数据的时候，他首先需要提供一个 AK 这样的 key， 然后去和盘上保存的AK 的哈希进行比较。如果不匹配的话，他就会直接拒绝这个 IO， 如果是匹配的话，他才会用这个 AK 去解密 DEK， 然后用 DEK 去对盘上加密的数据进行解密。讲解完硬件，接下来我们来看软件。根据 spec， OPPO 内部的 firmware， 它通过维护很多个表来记录这些信息。它会通过 ATA、NVMe 或者 SCSI 这种标准接口的一些命令来和 host 进行交互。比如ATA 的 trust send receive 或者 NVMe 的 security send receive。然后通过 driver 把配置信息按照 spec 里面定义的那些方式去构建，然后通过一些接口的命令，比方说刚才提到的 NVMe 的 security send receive， 然后发给设备 host 对 OPPO 把构建的 OPPO 指令发送给设备，并且负责收到 response 的解析。NVMe OPPO library 可以通过NVMe Manage 直接使用来配置你的 OPPO 设备，目前支持了大多数操作，比如说初始化、加锁、解锁、多用户、多 Locking Range 的支持等等。后面我们还会考虑引入对于BDAR 层的支持，具体命名的话会以到时候发布的版本为准。我们会在 NVMe BDAR 这层之上引入一个 OPPO 的 VBDAR， 把 OPPO 的配置命令直接通过 OPPO Library 发给磁盘，然后普通的 I/O 就直接 pass through 给 NVMe 的 Library。这是在解锁的情况下，如果对于没有解锁或者就是说就是本身没有授权这样的情况 ，I/O 就会直接返回失败。引入这样一层 VBDAR 主要是考虑到对于多用户的支持，因为 OPPO 它本身支持多个 locking range 的配置，这部分是硬件去决定的。每个 locking range 可以使用各自的密码去加锁解锁。Locking range 它的数量也受限于硬件，并不是可以无限增加的。SPDK 的 OPPO Library 它目前已经提供了对于硬件所支持的最大 Locking range 数量的查询。这一部分的代码预计会在下个 release 之前发布。OPPO 本身是一个系列的自家密盘的标准，这一个系列里面的标准之间会有一些比较细微的差别。我们的开发和测试都是基于 OPPO 2.0 这样一个标准，这也是目前使用最广泛的标准。但是理论上，对于其他这个系列的标准也是可以用的，只是可能有一些功能会不太一样，有些功能可能盘本身不支持。SPDK 的 NVMe OPPO 它理论上可以用在任何OPPO 支持的盘上，比如目前英特尔的 Optane P4800 和部分型号的 P4510， 还有其他公司的 OPPO 支持的这些盘都是可以用的。那么我们讲了这么多 Crypto VBDAV 和 OPPO VBDAV， 我们应该如何去选择呢？我们来总结一下。Crypto VBDAV 它的优势在于它可以不依赖于任何专门的硬件，使用通用的 CPU 和存储设备就可以完成数据加密，而且它可以建立在任何 Base VBDAV 之上，通用性更强。但是它的缺点就是在于加密的过程需要 CPU 的参与，会带来一些资源上的开销，也会有可能造成一些性能上的下降。而这部分的劣势恰好是 OPPO VBDAV 的优势。首先是因为 OPPO 它使用了专门的硬件进行加密，所以它对于 CPU 基本上没有什么资源上的开销，也不会造成性能上的下降。而且由于不需要 CPU 和内存这样的开销，所以它其实在安全上 也会更加安全。 因为重要的数据在CPU和内存里面停留的时间越短的话， 就可以认为就是比方说Hacker他去攻击的这个攻击面会变得更小， 就会能够提升整个软件站的安全性。 还有就是OPPO它作为一个自家密盘的标准， 它有着更完善的spec和更清晰的发展方向， 后面也可能会有更多功能的支持。 那么它的缺点也非常显而易见， 就是它只能建立在NVMe平台上， 而且使用起来会受到一些硬件的限制。 比如说它需要专门的OPPO支持的硬盘， 比如说多 locking ring这样的支持的话， 也是取决于硬件本身。 这两个方案的优缺点有那么一点互补， 所以我们的用户可以根据自己的需要进行一个选择。
那NVMe不加密可以支持这个NAPS内存，现在因为所有的盘只有一个NAPS内存，如果假如说未来有多个NAPS内存，你有个NAPS内存。你说是
NVMe OPPO 那块是吗？
对，
对， 对。 NVMe OPPO 那块的话，对于多 namespace 的支持，目前是还在他们整个组织要制定一个标准去做这一块，目前是还没有软件上有这一块的支持。
First is about the library to use. They say that the metadata should be stored at the persistent memory. So I want to know if they must use persistent memory or can use other SSD or memory.
Yeah, so that's a really good question. So one thing that Andy didn't actually touch on earlier was that you can use PMDK with a backing file that is not persistent memory. What it means though is that when you do the persist operation, it will create a block I/O. So it will be slow, but you can still use libreduce with something that's not exactly persistent memory. So if you have a system and you just want to use a Optane SSD or even a RAM disk, you can still do that.
Another question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Actually, it's about the keynotes. You just mentioned the SPDK and the integration with OpenStack is already done, seeing the plugins. I know you also mentioned the ongoing is the SPDK integration with the Kubernetes.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to know in more details about this project. What's the status?
Yeah, so Kubernetes has a CSI framework for doing these types of plugins. So that's what we're working on right now, is to build a plugin that will provide similar functionality to what the Cinder plugin does. I don't have an exact date. I think the plan is for that to be ready by the end of the year. One of the questions will be, when can we get it, you know, like upstream? But I would expect for that to be available by the end of the year.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hi. For encryption.
Yeah.
So when you do VBDev to support encryption on logical models that span maybe many disks, will you be synchronizing the keys between the disks so that you know the same it's belong to the same user, right? So the user has one key maybe.
You mean for VBDev?
Yes.
And if you build crypto VBDev on top of large volume, all the for the same crypto VBDev, it will use the same key for the same large volume.
So the drives, if the VBDev, if the logical volume is made of several drives.
Yeah, but if the crypto crypto VBDev per crypto VBDev, it use one key.
No, I mean in the Opal.
Opal.
In your design for the Opal.
Opal, okay. Yeah. Opal, you mean locking ring?
the self-encrypting drives?
The self-encrypting drives doesn't support logic clone. It can only be on top of NVMe.
Okay. Yeah. And there's no plan to allow it to support NVMe.
Due to hardware constraints, so OPPO can, we only plan to support OPPO for NVMe, not for ATA or SCSI for now. Yeah.
我也想问一下关于那个加密的方面，就是那个 OPPO 的话，我理解它只能在那个就是盘上做加密嘛。那如果我想用那个 Over Fabric 的方案的话，是不是只能用那个 Crypto 的那个 VB 带，它可以在 Host 这边做加密，就是保证在传输的那个网页上也是加密的。对
NVMe 这块 ，OPPO 的支持目前还没有，我们还没有进行，但是我们可以后面去调研一下，可不可以支持这个。
那对于那个对
crypto 这边可以，在
host 这边可以直接加密，然后再传，
对，在传输过程中也是，对，
谢谢。
好，欢迎那个大家下午准时回。